Okay. Couple things at the beginning. You're going to see a lot of numbers come up here about tonnage and length and width. And the issue is, when you look at the tonnage on a ship, it could be a standard displacement, it could be a light load, it could be a heavy load. So you can see several different tonnage numbers for the same aircraft carrier. And you can see difference in lengths and widths depending whether they gave me the dimensions of the hull or they gave me the dimensions of the deck itself. So just take them as flavor for a basic size, because you'll see what I mean when I get into it. Like Bob said, I'm going to go through, hopefully we'll end with World War II or maybe a little bit after that. And then the next session, this is more, I'll call it the nuts and bolts and how they evolved and everything. The second session will be the supercarriers and the aircrafts, and try to put you in the seats of flying aboard a ship and what they go through. There's some funny things in here, and I think you'll enjoy it. I'm experimenting with this, and so the people in the back, let me know. You might not be able to read the smaller numbers, but hopefully for a chance that I'll be able to, when I'm talking about something, you can see it there. I'll also have screens, which you'll see, that I'll have the bullet points or the primary things of talking about some of the early pilots and the ships. And then you'll see photos thereafter of all the ships and the planes to give you a better idea. So to get this thing started, I think what I'm going to do, just get out of this for a second, to get the blood flowing.
Get wings to fly. Oh, I'm alive. Yeah. When you call on me, when I hear you breathe, I get wings.
Come on.
Okay. Basically, this gentleman, a Frenchman, Clement Ager, back in the late 1800s, actually flew an engine-driven aircraft. And he called it the Ole. And he coined a word called avion, which means aircraft heavier than air. He was an electrical engineer, a mechanical engineer, and he was interested in aircraft design. The plane you see there, the Avion 3, was not the one he actually flew, but they say in 1890 he flew 160 feet 8 inches off the ground. Now, we always look at the Wright brothers, but that's what's been said. It was powered by a steam engine, of four cylinders that he built, and was quite an engineer. One of the other things he did, interestingly, is in Paris, he actually, I think, started Stereo Channel, if you can believe it. He wired this opera house and took it by telephone wire out to 2 miles where people could listen to the opera and hear left and right channels like we hear stereo. Now, this guy loved aviation. And one thing in 1909, he wrote a book, L'Aviation Militaire, which basically described how an aircraft carrier should look like in the future. He said it should have a flight deck, a flat flight deck with an island. It should have elevators to go to a hangar deck, and the wings should be able to be folded on the planes. Even to this day, they consider him the father of aviation. In the 30s, they published a postage stamp on behalf of him, and the companies, the conglomerate that makes the Airbus, actually named one of their assembly plants in France after him. So he was ahead of his time. The Avion here was the last one he built. I don't think it ever flew. It's in one of the museums, but you can tell his planes more look like a bat than an airplane. And then, of course, we know Wilbur and Orville Wright. They were noted for the three-axis control. In other words, they were able, with the rudders and a stick, to be able to fly the plane three-dimensionally and keep the plane in equilibrium. They created their own wind tunnel. And then there, they tested different wings and also the propeller. And what's interesting about the propeller, that his efficiency was 75 to 82%, where today's wind propellers, the max they've been able to do is 85%. So they really did a good job. Another gentleman, H.G. Wells, I always think of War of the Worlds, but here's this book he wrote. He wrote this in 1907, The War in the Air, and what he had was Germany invading by air our east coast, and the Asians invading our west coast by air. So he was ahead of his time too, even before Billy Mitchell. Now, I'll go through this bullet points real quick, and then you'll see the photos, as I mentioned before. What was going on in the early 1900s? Well, in 1910, Britain hosted a cross-country between London and Manchester. Later on, the first Paris to London flight, and that was flown by John Moisan, an American. Then in November, we had this gentleman named Eugene D. Eli. He flew off a light cruiser in the Chesapeake Bay. It had a small deck there. And then the following January, he landed on a deck on the Pennsylvania in the San Francisco Bay. He was the first one to use a tail hook, and the platform was 102 feet long, and he was caught by, they had sandbags on each side of the deck and a wire going across, and he caught, the 12 out of 22 wires. Then seaplanes started to appear. The French Navy had the first operational seaplane carrier, the Faudray. Pardon me if I can't pronounce French correctly. It could hold 8 aircraft. Now, the aircraft that we're talking now is all seaplanes, as far as carriers. And actually, when Clement talked about carriers too, these first carriers, all they literally did was hoist a seaplane on the deck. Excuse me, they first put it on the thing. They'd hoist it down in the water, take off and fly, come back on the water, and then they'd hoist it back on. So the first carriers were seaplane only. The British had Lieutenant Charles Sampson as the commander of the Royal Navy Air Services. Then in 1915, although it was commissioned later, Britain converted the Collier, a coal ship, into the HMS Ark Royal as the first carrier, although it was seaplanes only. It was about 7,000 tons, speed is not great, but it actually saw the first action in the Dardanelles in May of 1950 against the Turks. And then in 1915, the S-184 type seaplane was the first one to launch a torpedo that sank a Turkish merchant, and it was on the HMS Ben Lycree. So here's Eugene. Actually, he was not in the Navy. He was a barnstormer, and somehow he got connected with the Navy, but it shows him taking the takeoff on the Birmingham in late 1910, and then that following January, his first landing coming on board here, and you can see the deck just sort of slides right up here. So here's a better shot of Eli coming aboard on the landing, and here's the sandbags on both sides, and then there's, I doubt if you can see it, but there's wires going across each one of these. Now this gentleman is just showing taxiing a seaplane here, and he wanted to call it the Aero Hydroplane, and Winston Churchill didn't like that and insisted be called a seaplane. And I tend to agree with Winston Churchill versus Aero Hydroplane. Here's the French Fourgon. Again, it was converted to a cruiser aircraft carrier. In fact, the French, or I should say the English translation from what he called it, the Corsair Porte Avions, is cruiser aircraft carrier. It was a coal burning ship again, 6,000 knots, had better speed than the other one, 19 knots, and held 8 seaplanes. Here's the first HMS Ark Royal. Like us, they renamed different ships as they sank or they decommissioned them. But it was a British first aircraft carrier, again a converted collier, commissioned 1915, and I mentioned the tonnage before. Later on, it was renamed the Pegasus and became a training ship in 1938. Here's the short 184 aircraft and showing the torpedo that was used to sink the merchant. Now, just keep in mind, look at the size of the torpedo and the size of the aircraft. Okay, and I'm guessing we're going to say that's like 10, 12 feet, something like that. Just keep it in mind for later on. Now, here's the HSM Ben Lycree. Again, it's a seaplane. The hangar's in here. Again, they offload them and reload them after the flight. Pretty long ship and pretty good speed. Okay, now in the later 1910s, the HMS Argus, they started to build the HMS Argus in 1916, commissioned in 1918. It's the world's first what they call flush deck carrier. In other words, it's a flat top. And it's the first carrier that planes with wheels could land on versus seaplanes. Then in 1917, the HMS Furious, it was converted light battle cruiser to a flying off deck. It still had a single 18-inch gun on the aft, which surprises me. I keep thinking it should be 8 inches, but they say 18. And Commander Dunning landed a Sopwith Pup on board. However, a couple days later, he didn't land so well and he drowned. Then the HMS Hermes, again a converted cruiser, and this was the thing going on in these early years, is converting other ships, man-of-war ships, into these aircraft carriers. It's the first carrier with an island, and the plans were submitted by this Flight Commander Williamson back in 1915, but this came about in 1923. Now, the big thing now was the 1922 Washington Navy Treaty. And what that did, this is after World War I, obviously, and everybody was gung-ho on battleships and battle cruisers and the larger ships. And everybody is concerned that maybe we're getting too many. So this treaty said this is the number of ships that you can have, and this is the tonnage you're allotted. Now, since countries were building battleships and cruisers at the time, they said, well, what you can do is convert those hulls to an aircraft carrier. So that's what they did. And there were certain quotas. And you'll see some carriers that we build of good size, and then you'll see a little and say, why is that? Well, that was the only tonnage left under this treaty. So you'll see the size of our carriers go up and down. And the basic function, since they were converting the cruiser hulls to aircraft carriers, part of the cruiser's function was the eyes of the fleet. They had seaplanes that could be launched or catapulted off the ship. And so they're replacing some of those. So now the aircraft carriers considered the eyes of the fleet. You know, there wasn't too much bombing or anything, and they couldn't hold that much, to be honest with you. But that was the function. So the HM Argus in 1916, here it comes out. No island, but here is the first flight deck across the whole hull of the ship. Here's the hull, here's the bow, and the only reason I got this circled is you'll see all the carriers, except for maybe one or two, the bows are open to the exposure of the sea. And actually, some of the carriers you'll see will have a little flight deck on the secondary part down here. Now, here's the HM Furious, 1917. This is the guy that's got this 18-inch gun back here. And the other thing you should note is the angled deck, the slanted flying off deck. Now, as they say what I've read, and I'm not quite sure if this is true or not, but since the airplane had a skag or a little wheel on the back in there like this, they figured, well, if they angle the deck down, then when the plane takes off, the wings are really perpendicular, horizontal going off the thing. And I don't think it really proved that, or else we still have the angled decks today. At least that's the thought. So I'm not sure, but you'll see a lot of angled decks in the first of these ships. Now this guy, he was converted again, and a lot of these ships can get converted for better means. Here, they took the 18-inch gun off on the backside. They deleted that large superstructure, but here you can see this whole superstructure here was just completely taken out. And now, as I mentioned, here's two forward decks. Here's one down here, and then here's one up here. So a lot of the experimentation of the carriers was actually before and during World War II. And I gotta give accolades to the British. They're the ones that really came out with some of the best inventions that went on a carrier, and this was after World War II. Here's the Hermes. The first island, you can see, biplanes. The other thing we should notice is, it'll be hard, why is it doing that to me? There's, up here, there's an elevator in these ships, and you can see the elevator back here, and we'll talk about those later on also. Okay, going through the latter 20s, Japan, they built their first carrier, was called the Hosho, I hope that's pronounced correctly, in 1922. Small tonnage, 7,500 tons, pretty good flight deck, 500 some odd feet, 25 knots is good, could hold 26 aircraft. They even experimented with sort of like our landing mirror signal, system. It didn't work very well and they discarded it. It's the only Japanese aircraft carrier out of the 10 that survived World War II. Now here we're getting in late in the game. We come on and commission the USS Langley, which is a converted collier, in 1922. The CD1, what does that stand for? Well, the C stands for carrier, the V stands for fixed wing, and the one is it's the first carrier. And you'll see our numbers keep going sequentially, except when they're building some classes of ships, and in the middle of the build, maybe the war ends or something, and they cancel the rest of the ships that were going to be built. They'll just leave those numbers as nothing and start numbers thereafter. So you could have CV-26 as an example, and then all of a sudden the next one is CV-31. The language, now, in these treaties and that, both us and the Japan were allowed to have two carriers at 33,000 tons. Now again, what 33,000 tons are they talking about? Is that displacement? Is it deep? Whatever. So you're going to see different tonnage on these carriers, even though this says 33,000. So what did we do? We built 1927 the CV-2, which is the Lexington, and the Saratoga CV-3. Their displacement again, 38,500 on a deep load is 47.7, but yet they started out with 33,000 tons. So you see tonnage going all over this place. Then Japan, they built the Akagi in 1927 and the Kaga in 1928. Both are about the same size. Now they're below the 30,000 number. They're at 29.6. Pretty good size ships. Speed is good and holding the aircraft is pretty good. Now, one thing I'm going to do now is you sort of need like a scorecard on these ships. So everybody keep one. And if you're coming back next month, bring it with you, because this has got all the carriers that we have, excluding the 122 CV escorts, which we'll talk about. So here is the Hosho, the 7,500 ton carrier that Japan built. And the interesting thing about this guy is he's the only one that's ever had a round island.
Thank you, sir.
But if you look, here's that slanted deck again on the front. And again, all of these bows are open. The other thing that's kind of fun to look at in these early carriers is where did they put the smokestacks? And you're going to see all kinds of options in here. Now, this island was removed a year afterwards. Some concern about the turbulence over the deck when the planes were landing. And a lot of these carriers were also trying to keep the smokestacks somewhat away for several reasons, but that's why you'll see some interesting smokestacks in these. Now here's the Akagi, and in 1930, now the bow is up here. It almost looks like the bow is back here, but it's not. It's up here, and here's the island. So it's the front starboard side or the front right side. And unfortunately, this is a revision in the 40s, but the bow's this way. So this island here would have been up here. So now they converted this to the port side of the carrier. The only two left-handed or port side islands were built by the Japanese on two of their carriers. All the other islands are on the starboard or right side of the carrier. So here's a couple photos of the Kaga. What's interesting, again, now this guy's got 8-inch guns here. But here you see a flight deck down here in the bow, and you see a flight deck up here. The other thing, if you look closely right here, here is their smokestack coming out. As you remember on the old cars, it's like lake pipes coming out the side. You know, but this long horizontal smokestack. And on the other side is another one just like it coming out here. You can't see it in this, but that's where the 8-inch guns are. Okay, after the reconstruction, They took those horizontal smokestacks and converted it to this smokestack here, bringing the fumes and everything down here. Okay, now comes the Langley. As I said, it was a collier coal ship. This is what it is as a coal ship, the Jupiter. And basically what they did is they stripped all these booms, if you want to call them that. They strip all that off and they built this carrier top on both above the main line here, the main deck. Now check this guy's smokestacks. These could go up or down. So here's a biplane landing on it. They put the smokestacks down horizontally to hopefully maybe they wouldn't hit it or the turbulence, I'm not sure, but these smokestacks moved up and down. Now, because the way they built that above the first deck, it was called the covered wagon, and that was its icon. And here was its sort of patch that they had for the covered wagon. In 1937, it was stripped down here. It was too slow, and they took out that deck so they could haul in seaplanes again, and it became a seaplane tender. Then in February of 42, it was off Java, and a couple Japanese bombers or whatever hit them with a couple bombs. It didn't sink, but they decided just to scuttle it at that time. Okay, the Lady Lex, CB2. Now, he and the Saratoga were the big bruisers of the day. Because you look at the tonnage of those guys and the length of the deck, almost 900 feet, 100 feet wide. That's a pretty good sized ship. The rest of these carriers are sitting there in the 20,000 range or even less than 20,000. Now, when they were first built, again, these were somewhat modified. They have 8-inch guns on them also. They have two turrets here and two turrets in the back. And here's the Saratoga. Same thing. 8-inch guns back here and 8-inch guns there. Now, I'm not sure about the Saratoga when they were changed, but here's the 8-inch guns, close-up of it, and all along 5-inch. But in early 1942, they took these 8-inch turrets off at least and put in AAA in the aircraft fire. Now, this one I think shows a pretty good comparison in size. Here you got the Lexington and the Saratoga, and here is the Langley. So these guys, first they're three times heavier, and the flight deck's 2.6 times larger. So that sort of gives you a comparison of what's going on. Okay, now we have the thing where the fight between the admirals about, you know, aircraft carriers and battleships. Well, you know, if you look back in those days, now here's the old New Jersey that was decommissioned in 1920, but that was the before the new battleships came out, that was a pretty good sized ship. And you compare that to the Langley and you look at what flies, you got to say, I think the battleship's probably better too. I love the British too. I don't know if I'd ever name a biplane the Sopwith Cuckoo. The Sopwith Camel, I know Snoopy like that. And I know the Sopwith Pup, the poor guy got drowned when he crashed that plane. But the British actually had a lot of good ideas as far as the carriers. So then, of course, Billy Mitchell, he was Army Air Force, and he had his own mind, and actually he was, I think, a thorn in the side of the Army as well as the Navy. He did get the bomb and sink that battleship, although, as I understand, he cheated a little bit on the size of bombs he was allowed to use. He took bigger ones than that. At least that's what Gary Cooper was doing in the movie that I saw. Actually, and after the sinking, this cartoon came out. You can't read this, and I'll read it for you, but it says, the battleship bombing experiment, and this was in the newspapers, A stationary, defenseless target, and yet see how long it took bombing the planes to sink it. And this is an admiral back there. Of course, down here, the airplane guy, he's saying, yes, but we did sink it, didn't we? Now here's, at the time, we got all these biplanes and just starting to think about monoplanes, but you think, how much weight can they hold? Now, we knew they could hold a torpedo because we saw that back in 1915, and that was probably about 1,500 pounds. But the thought of one bomb or one 500-pound bomb, which some could hold, would not hurt one of these things, assuming they made it through the air defenses of the battleship. So I would agree with him. But anyway, he was court-martialed in 1925. They found him guilty. General MacArthur was on the board, and he found him not guilty, but they overrode him. So he was ahead of his time, too. Oops. Sorry about that. Okay, now, the CB-4 Ranger. This guy is only 14,000 tons, and he was kind of one of those, like it was the end of the quota under the 1922 Washington Treaty, Navy Washington Treaty. So he's 14,000 tons. He's not bad in size and not bad in aircraft, but so you'll see tonnage go up and you'll see tonnage go down. It's an ongoing saga. Now, look at this guy's smokestacks. Okay, so now he's down towards the back, and I would say, well, as a pilot, I don't know if I'd want to hit one of those if I'm going off the side. But anyway, everybody's experimenting where the smokestacks are going at this time. Another shot of him, I don't know how, probably some people here have been through the Panama Canal. But here is the Ranger going through the Panama Canal, and just for you that haven't gone through there, they use what they call electric mules. It's like a switching yard locomotive, and they tether up with the ships going through that or bring it through so they don't scrape the sides. And just to give you a better flavor, here's the Missouri going through the Panama Canal, and basically it cleared the sides by less than a foot on each side. And again, they tethered up with these electric mules to bring it into those locks. Now Germany wanted an aircraft carrier. They were building one here. Here's the Graf Zeppelin. The only problem was Marshal Goring of the Luftwaffe. He thought all the planes should be under his control and the Navy didn't need planes. So he basically convinced Hitler that instead of spending money on this aircraft carrier, he should spend the money on submarines. And so this never got commissioned, although it looks like a nice ship, at least in this, 28,000 tons, it's not bad, and good size and speed, great. Okay, now before the outbreak of World War II. The British carriers, what do they got? They got the Argus as a training carrier. They got the Ark Royal. This is the second Ark Royal, commissioned in 1938. It's up to 27,000 tons. The other thing I should say, too, is somewhere in these treaties, there was a London Treaty, too, that they were limiting aircraft carriers to 27,000 tons. Now, is that displacement or heavy load or light load? I'm not sure. But you'll see our Essex class, when they come out and start being built and being commissioned in the late 1942, they were 27,000 tons. And sometimes when you hear somebody talking about a 27 Charlie, that's an Essex class carrier. So the Charlie C for carrier and 27 is 27,000 tons. So you'll hear them called 27 Charlies. Actually, that's about what we heard over in Vietnam, because they had all the Charlies over there. At least, well, they had 13 of them. Okay, so they've got the Ark Royal, they got the Furious with two sister ships, the Courageous and Glorious. They have the Hermes and the Eagle. Now, the Eagle was going to be a battleship and sold to Chile. However, with the war outbreak, they thought they better keep it, and so they made it an aircraft carrier. The French carrier had the Bourne, a nice looking ship. Never saw action, though. And the first task of these carriers was to either hunt for U-boats with aircraft and try to sink them, and the eyes of the fleet. The Ark Royal did find a U-39, and it was sunk by destroyers. The Ark Royal Skua aircraft found U-boat 30, and unfortunately, they bombed with no luck, except two of the Skuas. They were so low, they blew their own tails off from the bomb. They ditched, and the submarine captured. So they didn't, I guess, were POWs for the rest of the war. And then in September, the Courageous was sunk by U-boat 29. Now, this is the famous swordfish, the one that torpedoed the rudder on the Bismarck. Again, look at the torpedo size. This is bigger than before, and actually for a biplane, he's a pretty good size. And the ceiling, 19,000 feet, is good. Loaded, he could do one torpedo, 1,200 pounds, or one pound under, instead of the torpedo. And max speed wasn't too bad for a biplane. Now here's the Skua dive bomber. This guy didn't last long at all, from 1938 to 1941. But again, now his speed is almost 100 miles per hour faster. The service ceiling is good, 20,000, but max load is 1,500 pound bomb. And so that's why I was saying, between the biplanes and the beginning of the monoplanes, I don't think everybody considered the aircraft as much of a threat. The one thing I should point out, and you'll see it later on, it's not the aircraft carrier that makes it such a lethal weapon, it's the planes that fly off of it. And primarily, you take the battleship New Jersey. Now, it can lob a 2,000-pound shell 20 to 22 miles. But these guys eventually can lob a 2,000-pound bomb 300 or 400 miles. So the flexibility is just unbelievable. But at the beginning, I can understand why there was a big turmoil about it. Now, some of our planes, what do we have? We had the Dauntless Dive Bomber. They built almost 6,000 of them. Nice plane, good speed. Bomb loads at 2,250. Here a guy is coming in for a landing because his tail hook's down. And down here you can see, here, as well as here, the perforated flaps, and that was to keep the tail from buffeting. And I'm noticing here, this guy has been shot up, if you look at these holes back here. Another one is the SB-2C Hell Diver, affectionately known as Son of a Bitch Second Class. they loved the thing, I guess. They built 7,000 of it. They could handle 2,000 pounds internal, 1,000 pounds external. But the funny thing is, they took a model of this into the wind tunnel at MIT, and the aeronautical engineer said, if they have any sense, they won't make more than one of these. But I guess we didn't have any sense, so we made 7,000. Okay, the HMS Eagle, commissioned in 1924. Again, a converted World War I battleship, 27,000 tons. Not a bad carrier. You know, it had a decent speed, not as well as we'd like, 30 knots or better. And here's the Bourne from France. Commission, nice lines in that, but never saw combat. Now we get to the Yorktown class and carriers. These are all about 26,000 tons, good speed, actually can hold a lot of aircraft, 800-foot flight deck. And we had three in this class. We had the CV-5 Yorktown, and actually the class is always called the first name of that ship is, in this case, the Yorktown class, and then thereafter there was the Yorktown class. So the Enterprise, the CV-6, and the Hornet CV-8. These were the first one to have hydraulic catapults, and you may say, what happened to CV-7? Well, we'll go into him. Now, here's the three ships, and the Hornet, that's a famous one. Here's the Yorktown, fully loaded. You got biplanes up here and monoplanes back here, and then the Enterprise CV-6. Now, here's the Wasp. He was the missing number. He was a small little dude compared to them. He was about 19,000 tons. And again, he was reduced by that Navy treaty quota. He is the first guy that had a test on an outside elevator. Now, in this case, it's nothing more than a steel beam going out here so they can put the skag or the back of the plane out there and then bring it up on deck. But this was the first one outside elevator versus the ones that are on the deck. Okay, now the unsung hero, they made 122 of these guys, CDEs, carrier fixed wing, E is for escort. Now these are baby guys. They can't displace more than 10,000 tons, and actually a lot of them were built just to simply carry aircraft to another place, as Africa or Russia. But what they also did for the convoys is they could look for the subs and spot those. So they were very important as far as transportation as well as protecting the convoys, which helped a lot in the Atlantic. Now, out of this class, there was several classes of CDEs, but the two biggest ones was the Casablanca, that there were 50 of those made, and the boat class was 105. I should also say that we built 151 carriers during this era, and these represented 81% of all the carriers built. And they were very important to, again, the convoys. Now here's one of the classes, a smaller one, the Long Island class. Here, they said you could hold 46 on the deck. In this one, I counted 42. So maybe some of these planes are a little bit bigger than others. But I counted 42 and they could do 16 in the hangar. Now the other interesting thing, and you'll see in a second if you can read it, it's kind of small. But here, when we build a ship for ourselves, we give it the numbers of the letters CDE-1, CDE-2, 3, and whatever. When we were built for the British, they called them BABG. And to be honest with you, I don't know what that means. Then in the slide I'm going to show you next, you'll see like another HMS name, but it'll say CD-32. What happened there is it was originally built for us and then either sold or given to the British, and they would keep the CDE-whatever, but then they had renamed it. Now here's the Casablanca class that there was 50 built. The guy up here, it's 7,800 and 10,009 tons loaded. Down here we got the boat class. There was 45 of those. A little bit bigger here, although I'm not sure what that tonnage means. Now here's all the CDEs. And so if I went down here, I don't expect you to be able to read that, but it says HMS Empress CDE-38. So it was originally one of our escort carriers, and it was then given to the British, and they just kept the CDE, but changed the name. Okay, now comes, to me, the best class of all, the Essex class carriers, or the 27 Charlies. They had 24 built, none were ever sunk, some were heavily damaged, but none ever sunk. They introduced, remember, the Wasp that had that little elevator on the side. They introduced the portside elevators on the carriers. Now, what's so important about that? The problem with the elevators that are on the deck itself is, if those elevators are down and the enemy comes in and bombs the carrier, and you can't get the elevator up, how's the planes going to land? Or how are they going to take off? And so that was an issue. And now if you look at the super carriers, you know, next time, most of the elevators are on the sides. But this was an important change. And these guys, under the London Naval Treaty I mentioned before, they could go up in size, they can go up a little bit in length. And in our case, we could hold 90 to 100 aircraft on the ship. And normally they were Hellcats, or some of it second class, TDF Avengers, and F-4U Corsairs. Now, 11 of these, after, well, 11 of these also served in the Korean War. And then, with the modifications of angle decks, steam catapults, and the landing mirror system, 13 of them served in Vietnam. Now, in my case, I was on the Coral Sea. I'm a 64,000 ton carrier, and these guys are 27,000 ton carriers. So the F-4 couldn't come aboard the 27 Charlies. The A-3 can, I don't know how they do it, but anyway, I guess it's the cats, it couldn't give us enough speed on liftoff. So there's some big size differences in these things. And then, as I said, the Coral Sea, after the Essex, they started to build the Midway. There was three of them. There was the Midway, there was the FDR, and there was the Coral Sea. We didn't come out until after World War II. So they didn't get to see World War II at all. Now, since I'm talking about the Lexington, this is yours truly, me. This is the first carrier I land on. And of course, the Lexington CV-16 had an angle deck when I did it, thank God. But I did that back in 66. This guy is the longest served carrier that we've had. It's been 50 years that guy was in service when he was decommissioned in 1991. So I got to give him some big kudos. So here's some of your Essex class carriers. The Yorktown, of course, the other Yorktowns we know got nailed in the Midway, Battle of Midway. So now we got the Yorktown name again, CV-10. And that's why you need a crib sheet, because, you know, which Yorktown are you talking about when you mention it to somebody, or the Lexington. Now, it's hard to see here, but they must be having a meeting or something, because all these sailors are sitting down. But here you can see they're either working on a 1,000 or 2,000 pound bomb. And again, here's that port elevator that came out on the Essex class. Now, they still have elevators here, but this was a big improvement. And here's just a few more. Again, you can see the port side elevators. You can still see the open bows. There's a few more. Oh, the Hancock. Now, here's the elevator down. Gives you a good shot down there. The interesting story about the Hancock is they were issuing war bonds to build these carriers, and John Hancock Insurance here went to the government and said, we'll help you get the war bonds if you will name it the Hancock. And so that's how it got its name. Now, here's the Leyte, CV-32. And I don't know if you can see down here, but it looks like a set of wings, and it says Leyte, and these are all the sailors grouped together to form that, with an anchor going down the center. But again, you can see the port side elevator in the opening on these. In this case, this one photo had the F-9F Panthers on it, which means it was in the Korean War at that time. So the jets are on this guy. The Boxer, CV-21, and the Hornet, CV-12. And this is why the open bow is not too neat when you're in a typhoon or a hurricane. So it's hard to kind of fly off that, although it gives it that slanted deck like the biplanes, and maybe they could do something there. Here's all the sailors. This was the 75,000th landing, so they're advertising this in this photo. So again, here's yours truly. I made the 185,000th landing on the Coral Sea off of San Francisco. And here's the Golden Gate, and here's Coral Sea. And I didn't know what I did. They came down, gave me a plaque later on, but they came down with a lot of like big birthday cakes for the whole squadron and everything. So, and if I look at when this thing was commissioned, and I take my year, and I see when it was decommissioned, they had to have well over 300,000 landings on that before it was scrapped. So it served a pretty good time also. Obviously, I'm proud, you know. Hey, what can I say? Okay, now FDR. Actually, I think the president really knew something for a change versus what we go through today. Yes, sir.
Wasn't he Secretary of the Navy earlier?
FDR?
Is it possible?
A system.
Yeah, system.
Okay, so there's a
My advisor's telling me yes.
Well, Bob, a system.
Okay.
Well, maybe
my
that's the reason.
Yeah.
But I got to tell you, he was concerned that the Essex class wasn't coming out till towards the end of 42. And he says, I need some more carriers out there. And he says, why don't we convert some of our light cruisers to carriers? And they're saying, no, you know, it's small. You got to think about the center of gravity. What are you going to do for hangars? And yada, yada, yada. But fortunately, he insisted and he got his way. So they converted these light cruisers to CDLs now, carrier, fixed wing, light. Okay? So here we go. Here is the Cleveland class cruiser. Maybe he didn't like Cleveland as a president. Maybe I'm not sure about that. But anyway, so here's this guy, pretty good size, almost 12. Well, again, we got two different tonnages here, which is fair. But it had speed. That was the one good thing. They argued against all the other things. Well, center of gravity and all that stuff, but it had the speed. But anyway, this is what it looks like as a cruiser. This is what it looks like as a CBL. Now, maybe I'm into smokestacks, but look at these guys over here. So they're bringing them out the side and up. And here's a good shot of these elevators, inside elevators. So if one of those are down and you get bombed, I hope I'm not up in the air and need to land on that guy. But that was the issue with the inside elevators. Here's another CDL. Again, same stack thing. Not a bad ship, though, really. Okay, again, trying to compare sizes. Up here in the top is a CDL, 15,000 tons. Next to it is the Hornet, Essex class, 26,000 tons. Look at the difference in size. Again, here's another Essex. And then here's one of the two big guys, the Saratoga. And look at the size of him, 38 tons versus 26 tons versus 15. So this one gives you a pretty good flavor of the size, although all of them, if you just saw them yourself, you'd say, wow, they're all big. Okay, now the HMS Hood. And I know we have a gentleman here from England, so if you want to add something, please be my guest. This was the last battlecruiser built by the British. And we know what happened, unfortunately. Out of the crew of 1,400, only three survived this. England was aggravated, obviously, and they said, we've got to get the Bismarck. So here comes the Ark Royal with the fairy swordfish that you saw before. Okay, that was the colored photo. Not a bad biplane at all, and the carrier, the Ark Royal now is looking pretty good. Well, they find the guy, and we know the story. The torpedo hit the rudder; it could only go in a circle, and fortunately here, you know, only 114 people survived this out of 2,200. Okay, now Pearl Harbor. Don't need to talk about that. And why I've been talking about torpedoes is, look at the torpedo that the Japanese used when they went into Pearl Harbor. Here's the guy. This guy's got to be two or three times the size. Rob, what do you call those torpedoes?
Long lance.
Long lance?
The long lance.
So, I mean, this thing is huge compared to what we were used to looking at in those other ones. Again, to try to compare some sizes here, let's look at three different classes here. We've got the escorts, the jeeps, or baby carriers. Oh, by the way, sir, the British called the CBEs Woolworths. Do you know why? No? Okay.
Woolworths were over there.
Maybe they thought they were five and dime stores, you know, carriers. But here's the end. He's 500 feet. Here's the light cruiser or carrier, 625, and then here's the Essex, almost up to 900 feet. Just again to give you some flavor of the size and differences of all these carriers that are being built. Okay, now comes Colonel Doolittle at the time, General later, and Hornet. And these are actual photos of his flight here. And fortunately, even though they court-martialed Billy Mitchell, this bomber was named after Billy Mitchell, B-25. Now we're at the Battle of Coral Sea in May of 42. This is a Lexington CB-2 blowing up. That was the sister ship to the Saratoga. And so we'll get another Lexington later on, the 16. And here's Midway. Now, the scorecard for this is USA, we lost one carrier, the Yorktown, and they lost four. Now, here's some actual photos. Here's the carrier Soryu that's been bombed. And it appears from the photos I've seen, they seem to want to go in circles, and maybe they're thinking, as long as they're turning, it's harder for bombers or torpedoes to hit them as they're going down. I'm not sure, but these are just photos of Midway. Here's another one. Here's another carrier. Again, he's turning. There's a carrier that's in flames. And here's one of their cruisers. Now, this guy got sunk, but look at the damage on this guy. So you can say planes can be very destructive. And here's the Yorktown being hit. He survived that, however, he was sunk by the Japanese I-168 submarine. Now we get to me shut up for a second and show you a flick.
During World War II, the aircraft carrier supplanted the battleship as king of the sea. These magnificent ships changed the way naval warfare was fought. The remarkable motion picture footage you're about to see will give you a close-up look into the lives of the thousands of sailors who served aboard these giant carriers, ships with flight decks longer than three football fields. As the carrier steamed to their theaters of operation with no perils in sight, there was time for a little fun to keep the men loose. These truly were floating cities with a population of 3,500, equipped with everything from soda fountains to libraries to reasonably comfortable sleeping quarters. The men were well cared for. But life between missions often meant weeks of unending boredom on these huge ships. And fear was ever present. These men had to be ready to react on a moment's notice. Planes are launched to respond to a threat in the area. This footage was taken from the gun cameras of U.S. fighters here attacking a Japanese reconnaissance plane. Typically, when a U.S. naval task force is discovered by the Japanese, these commanders must immediately decide what to do. A strategy session is held as guns and planes are readied for action. Then, the call comes in.
Pilot, man your plane. Pilot, man your plane.
There's not a minute to spare. One by one, the carrier's aircraft are launched to protect the great ships from the oncoming Japanese attack planes. Fanning out overhead, the fighters do their best to protect the task force.
I
The attack is repulsed, but not without casualties, and nothing is more dangerous than a shipboard fire. The enemy could always return, sometimes with disastrous consequences for the Allied fleet. But Allied planes would get their turn too. You are about to see some of the best combat footage ever filmed from the wings of American planes. As the war progressed, the Japanese had fewer and fewer skilled pilots to take to the skies and protect their ships. Once the target was sighted, there was no escape. Remember, these are not recreations. You're watching the real thing in real time, as the pilots saw it. Time to head back to that floating airstrip called home. For some, it's much easier said than done. It's the job of these men to guide the planes in for a safe landing, taking into account the crosswinds, the pitch of the ship, and the shape of the plane that's landing. Once again, fire rears its ugly head. It's crucial to douse the flames as soon as possible because of the fuel and munitions stored on the ship's deck. These men are risking their lives to save the life of a trapped pilot who had been unable to release his leaking incendiaries. With the plane's fuel tanks still holding 75 gallons of high-octane gas, the chance of explosion is real. The men who braved this danger deserve every citation they get. But not all the damage is to the planes. The windshield you're about to see is bloodstained from the wound suffered by a brave pilot. Somehow, he managed to land the plane. This is the true face of war. And still, they limp home. And the casualties mount as the battle goes on. Another squadron home to roost. Unbelievably, most of the men in these crashes survived to fight another day. Damaged planes are pushed over the side to clear the decks. The pilots say, any landing you can walk away from is a good one. Unfortunately, not everyone is able to walk away. The sacrifice of these pilots and crews enabled the Allies to turn the tide of the war against the Japanese. Their heroism changed the balance of power in the Pacific, as did the courage of bomber crews in Europe who helped change the course of the war against Germany.
Hey, the reason I said see that plane flip over, well, I'm going to tell you a little about our survival training in the Navy. The thing that you see here is called the Dilbert Dumper. And what it does is we strap in there, it goes down this track, flips upside down, and then sinks. And so we're trained to figure out how to get out of that thing before we drown. The other things we had to do in that flight school, we swam a mile with clothes on, minus the shoes. We had to tread water for a half an hour in the last 3 minutes with your hands in the air. And we talked about ejecting underwater, and I'll talk about that later on. The survival gear we had, at least in the jet, was really unbelievable, everything that we had. The one thing, while we were over in Nam, they took out the shark repellent because they said it was worthless and put something else in place of it. But the thing I thought was most important was the solar stiff, and I'll show you something later. They also, since then, and actually since my training in 65 and 66, it's somewhat different, and you'll see a clip on what they do now, and I'll talk a little bit as it's going on. They also now have the counterpart for helicopters, because helicopters, most of the time, when they go in, all the weight's on the top, so they flip upside down, too. So they go through the same thing. Now this guy, he's got oxygen here. Now when we did it, we didn't have that. So we had, you had your breath to get out of here. And now our releases were different here. I guess they're assuming now everybody has jets. And also we had our oxygen mask on when we were there on the jets. But here's a problem. Nobody knows how fast these things sink. And they normally say, well, maybe 10 feet a second. But the trouble is breathing 100% oxygen, once you get below 80 feet, it becomes poisonous to you. So the time this guy's taking, it's like, you're going to be at the bottom of the ocean by the time you get out.
What else is he fussing on?
I don't know. Now, we had that quick release here. Now, in the jet, we had to unhook. Well, most of the time, hopefully we weren't in it. We already ejected, but I can talk about that next time. But here's the Hilo version. A lot of countries have these, by the way. I mean, you can go on YouTube and put in Dilbert Dunker in YouTube or something. You'll get all kinds of videos there.
What was that, Dover?
Dilbert. D-I-L-B-E-R-T, like that cartoon guy. Dilbert. Or put in Helicopter Dunker.
That's easy to remember.
Show is that when these things roll over, they go over violently because the engine is still running.
Oh, yeah.
The laser thrusher.
Yeah.
The blades are probably the most dangerous part of the helicopter.
You're absolutely right. I wouldn't want to be in a helicopter if it goes in the water, to be honest with you. Now, here's the solar still. I thought that was, besides the life raft itself, I thought that was the most important because basically you put in salt water and then from the sun it evaporates and the fresh water trickles down the side, so it gives you something to drink. Now this one I pulled out of the internet, and actually I guess for boaters and that, this is $275 for this guy here. And I don't know how big it is. Ours was maybe about this big, not as labored as this. Okay, let's see, continuing on here. Okay, here's one, the Essex class. It almost got nailed. You can tell it's hurt pretty bad. It was taken under tow, but later it was able to go on its own at 14 knots to go in for repairs. And again, here's the issue. Here's those elevators, and even if, you know, so that's the problem with those guys. Now, we got Little Boy and Fat Man, the two atomic bombs that we did in World War II. These are some photos of the Little Boy. They brought it in over, it's like one of those old places where you drove in your auto and you had that below the pit thing. It had a hydraulic like in the gas stations. And here you can tell sort of the size. Here's a guy that's going to put it up into the B-29. So, in fact, you can see the B-29 doors here. And here's the Fat Man. Obviously, he is huge. I don't know what his weight is. He was a different type of bomb. Now, these bombs, I was a nuclear weapons officer, too. And these bombs, depending on who you talk to, say is between 16 and 20 kilotons. You know, what the damage they did. Okay, here's, and I pulled this off the internet, so I'm not conveying anything I shouldn't say, but here is a bomb in the 60s, the V-61, about 1,000 pounds, and this guy was well over five times the size and kiloton rating as those bombs before. This guy is smaller than my wing tank. So that just gives you a flavor. The free fall, I would say normally the airburst is the choice of selection. The parachute would be, it'd give you more time to get away from the weapon as it's floating down slower than, and the wind carriage makes no difference when you're playing with bombs this size. Okay, that's the end of World War II. Now, do you guys want another 10 or 15 minutes or do you want to go home? It's your pleasure. Okay, I'll do one more thing. This is the part I really love. Okay, the Midway comes out again. Coral Sea were there. Now I call it the big boys are coming, and here you got the 64,000 ton babies. Now, the war ended. Now what happens in 1949? This is called the Revolt of the Admirals, and basically, in December of 49, Secretary of Defense Lewis A. Johnson stated, "There's no reason for having a Navy and Marine Corps. General Bradley tells me that amphibious operations are a thing of the past. We'll never have any more amphibious operations. That does away with the Marine Corps, and the Air Force can do anything the Navy can do nowadays. So that does away with the Navy." My hair's probably sticking up on end, even though this is going on. Okay. And I got to read you this because I couldn't say it as well as this does. In November 1943, General of the Army George C. Marshall called for a post-World War II unification of the Department of War and the Department of the Navy. These proposals led to what became known as the unification debates and the eventual passage of the National Security Act in 1947. That act reorganized the military, creating a unified national military establishment, renamed the Department of Defense. The National Security Council included CIA and the independent United States Air Force. The generals of the newly formed Air Force propounded a new doctrine, that strategic bombing, particularly the nuclear weapons, was the sole decisive element necessary to win any future war. and was therefore the sole means necessary to deter an adversary from launching a Pearl Harbor-like surprise attack or war against the United States. To implement this doctrine, which the Air Force and its supporters regarded as the highest national priority, the Air Force proposed that it should be funded by the Congress to build a large fleet of U.S.-based long-range strategic heavy bombers. The Air Force generals argued that this project should receive large amounts of funding, beginning with an upgraded B-36 Peacemaker intercontinental bomber. That thing was huge. It's huge. The admirals of the Navy disagreed, obviously, pointing to the overwhelming dominance of the aircraft carrier in the Pacific theater. They asked the United States Congress to fund a large fleet of supercarriers in their supporting battle groups, beginning with the USS United States. The Navy leadership believed that wars could not be won by strategic bombing alone, with or without the use of nuclear weapons. The Navy also maintained to decide at the outset of any future conflict to initiate the widespread use of nuclear weapons. Attacking the major population centers of the enemy homeland was immoral. The United States was, however, designed to support a 100,000-pound aircraft, which would be large enough to carry the multi-ton nuclear weapons of the day. The plans for the United States called for carrying 14 heavy bombers, each in enough aviation fuel for 8 raids per plane, allowing the U.S.-United States supercarrier to drop 112 nuclear bombs before resupply became necessary. Personally, I think that's a lot of BS. I don't think those planes are going to make it back for 12 more sorties. You know, the admirals argued that this project should receive a large amount of funding for 8 of the supercarriers over a 5-year period. Cancellation of the United States class ships. The first Secretary of Defense, former Secretary of the Navy, James Forrestal, we'll name a class of carriers after him, supported the Navy position and authorized construction of the United States with a production run of 5 ships. However, he was asked to resign by President Truman following a series of budgetary disagreements on March 28, 1949, and was replaced by Lewis A. Johnson, who supported Truman's budget limits and the Air Force argument as superior. On April 23, less than a month after taking office, and without consulting Congress, Johnson ordered cancellation of the U.S. Carrier. Secretary of the Navy John L. Sullivan and a number of high-ranking admirals resigned in protest. A few days later, Johnson announced that the aviation assets of the United States Marine Corps would be transferred to the Air Force. This plan was quietly dropped in response to an uproar in Congress. The Navy's aircraft carriers were normally disliked by the Air Force, as they were an aviation asset which the Air Force could not control, thank God, and which the Air Force planners considered obsolete in the age of nuclear weapons. Johnson, who was a staunch proponent of the new nuclear bomber force, consequently sought to limit as much as possible the Navy's procurement of the new large carriers to conserve funds in the markedly reduced post-war military budget. A research group, OP-23, headed by Captain Arleigh Burke, began to gather material critical of the B-36's performance and capabilities. An anonymous document soon appeared claiming that the B-36 was a billion-dollar blunder and alleging fraud on the part of the B-36 contractors. The document stated that Johnson, who had been on the board of directors of Convair, manufacturer of the bomber, had personal interest in its production. The situation was further exacerbated by a series of articles for popular consumption written by Rear Admiral Daniel Gallery for the Saturday Evening Post. The final article, "Don't Let Them Scuttle the Navy," was so inflammatory that Johnson wanted Gallery court-martialed for gross insubordination. Gallery barely escaped the court-martial, but the article cost him his promotion to Vice Admiral and ultimately ended his career. The debate that caused the revolt had been building for several years. The climax in late 1949, when many of those officers, including Chief of Naval Operations Lewis Denfield, were either fired or forced to resign. Result of congressional hearings. In his final report, the House Armed Services Committee found no substance to the charges relating to the roles of Johnson and Secretary of the Air Force Stuart Symington in aircraft procurement. It held that the evaluation of the B-36 Worth was the responsibility of the Weapons Systems Evaluation Group, and that the services jointly should not pass judgment on weapons proposed by one service. On cancellation of the supercarrier, the committee questioned the qualifications of the Army and the Air Force Chiefs of Staff, who had testified in support of Johnson's decision to determine vessels appropriate for the Navy. The committee disapproving of Johnson's summary manner of terminating the carrier and his failure to consult congressional committees before acting stated that national defense is not strictly an executive department undertaking. It involves not only the Congress, but the American people as a whole speaking through their Congress. The committee can in no way condone this manner of deciding public questions. The author of the so-called anonymous document turned out to be Cedric Worth, civilian assistant to the Undersecretary of the Navy. A House investigating committee recommended that Worth be fired. Following a naval court of inquiry, Worth was dismissed.
The committee.
Excuse me?
No, I just said Joe. I said he was worthless.
No. The committee expressed solid support for effective unification, but stated that there is such a thing as seeking too much unification too fast, and observed that there has been a Navy reluctance in the inter-service marriage and over-ardent Army, a somewhat exuberant Air Force. It may well be stated that the committee finds no unification Puritans in the Pentagon. Finally, the committee condemned the dismissal of Admiral Denfield, Secretary of the Navy Francis P. Matthews, fired Denfield on October 27, 1949, explaining that he and Denfield disagreed widely in strategic policy and unification. The House Armed Services Committee concluded that Denfield's removal was a reprisal because of his testimony and a challenge to effective representative government. Army General Omar Bradley, chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, called the Navy Admirals fancy dance who won't hit the line with all they have on every play unless they can call the signals, who were in open rebellion against the civilian control. This was as much for budgetary reasons as any other. The services were then in the middle of post-World War II drawdown, which would continue into and past Korean War era, and each military branch believed that their future depended on securing as many missions for themselves as possible. It's still, and they go on, it's continuing to, I think to this day, he says, you know, as of 2012, you know, these debates continue on. It doesn't upset me. And how I look at it, of course, this is hindsight in 2020, but as I say, now let me understand this. We had the Korean War, we had amphibious landings, we had aircraft carriers over there, and look at the Vietnam War. Now, obviously the Navy did something right. The Air Force actually liked the F-4 that we developed. And then one of the generals, we had the AIM-9 Sidewinder, the heat seeker, and the Air Force had the AIM-4 Falcon. Now, I'm just reading what I've read in the internet on the AIM-4, but it was not near as good as the Sidewinder. One of the main reasons is it had to contact the bogey aircraft for it to explode. In our case, it will explode when it's passing something close by. But one Air Force general, he wanted the Sidewinder, and the guys above him, they said no. And he said, to hell with them anyway, and had, I think it was Raytheon, rewired his F-4s to handle the Sidewinder. And then, of course, the other generals above, they were irritated, but then they ended up changing all the AIM-4s and all the F-4s to the Sidewinder. So there's good to have competition and get things from each service. Then we had the Libyan issue, and you talk about aircraft carriers. Well, we had a carrier over there in the Med, and we had the A-6s and A-7s come over and bomb. Now, the Air Force couldn't, this is me talking now, the Air Force couldn't get away with that. We got to do something. So they had the F-11 Aardvark over in England. But France and Spain
wouldn't let you fly over.
Yeah. Okay, so that was an additional 1,300 miles each way to get the F-111 Aardvark over there. Nothing against the plane, but, you know, everybody's got to be in the game. You know, it's easier to move a floating carrier around than it is to, you know, do a new runway. Then we had the Iraqi war. Now, good for the stealth bomber. I got to go back legs for the Air Force for this. But where did that thing take off from? It took off in Missouri.
Missouri.
And it flew all the way over there. The flight was almost 30 hours, and all the refueling. Now, it's a great plane, nothing wrong, but it's a lot easier to have an aircraft carrier and do it. And there's other things like Air Force's silos. When you put in concrete, you're not going to move it too easy where we got the subs. And I could go on. Now, actually, I'm a little prejudiced. And so, it's like when we go to build an airfield, the Navy, we say, okay, we'll use money to build the runway first. If there's money left, we'll do the officers club. And then if there's money left, we're going to do a golf course. Now, the Air Force, I think, looks at it this way. First, the officers club, then the golf course, and then the runway. So this is how I imagine an aircraft carrier would look like if the Air Force got to do it. Okay, so you know, we have a little landing pad here for the helos, for the dignitaries when they come in. We got the O Club. There's dancing in the evening up here on the island. No sand traps, but a lot of water hazards. I won't go that. So I think I'll end this on this. I got one more thing for you, but that's what happens if the Air Force gets to take over the Navy, in my opinion, my humble opinion. Okay. And here's this one.